morning to each and every one of you. Good morning.
Good morning.
Well, it's nice to see you all here today. I was a little bit concerned this morning when I looked out of the window up at Windy Gates. It was windy. But thank goodness it's calmed down a little bit down here. Just a couple of things to draw your attention to on your order of service. Number three on your list, we'll be delighted to witness the baptism of Maisie, daughter of Mr. and Mrs. Monsaka, next week here in the church, and we look forward to that. And we're looking to start our coffee mornings up again, not on a Wednesday, because the St. Margaret's Church across the road are having one on Wednesdays, so we don't want to compete with them. So we're looking to do it on a Tuesday, so if you could help in any way, by baking or setting up or serving, please contact the church office. And please pass that information on to anyone who you think might be able to help in that respect. Now, I'm going to ask Mary to read a very important edict out to you, which is of very great importance to the congregation. Mary?
James Fisher, member of this congregation, has been elected to be a ruling elder. James Fisher has accepted office as elder. If anyone has any objections why this member should not be ordained to office, they state their objection at the meeting of the Kirk session in Leven Parish Church, Lesser Hall, on Sunday, 21st August 2022 at 10:45 a.m. If no relevant objection regarding life or doctrine is made and substantiated, the Kirk session will proceed to ordination. By order of the Kirk session, Mary Walker, session clerk.
Thank you, Mary, thank you. So that's a very important event in the life of this church. Next Sunday we will have a baptism, and the Sunday after we'll have an ordination of a new elder. There's a couple of interesting weeks, different weeks. But this morning we come together to worship God. We come as his people. We come to express our gratitude and thanks for his loyalty to us, for his presence with us throughout all our lives, that he's been there, holding our hands, carrying us through the difficult times, holding us up when all we want to do is sit in the corner and scream, showing us a way forward, showing us there is light at the end of our particular tunnel, showing us that the past, the present, and the future are safe with him. Let's then begin by singing that first hymn on our order of service, hymn number 132, Immortal, Invisible, God Only Wise, 132. now we simply unite as one family and come before God in prayer. Let us pray. O Lord our God, your love for humankind was present there in the beginning of all things, and it has extended through history, and it touches each one of our lives here. Your love sees our failings and forgives. Your love feels our pain and wipes away our tears. Your love knows our grief and comforts us in times of sorrow. Your love sees our sin and still loves us, the sinner. And so, O Lord, we acknowledge all of that. And it's because of that that we come before you today and ask that you forgive us. Forgive us when we fail to live lives that reflect your love. Forgive us for the many, many times we take for granted all that you have done for each one of us. Transform us, Father. Change us. Change us through your Spirit. And empower us. Empower us to serve you this day and all days. Give us the energy, the strength, and the confidence to be your people in this world today. This we ask in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord and Saviour, who taught us when we come together as one family to say together the words of that family prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power and the glory forever. We take our reading this morning from the Old Testament, Isaiah chapter 40, verses 21 to 31. You'll find that on page 678 of the Pew Bible. Isaiah 40, verses 21 to 31. And I'll ask Lynn to read that for us this morning.
Let us hear the word of God. Have you not known? Have you not heard? Has it not been told you from the beginning? Have you not understood from the foundations of the earth? It is he who sits above the circle of the earth, and its inhabitants are like grasshoppers, who stretches out the heavens like a curtain and spreads them like a tent to live in, who brings princes to naught and makes the rulers of the earth as nothing. Scarcely are they planted, scarcely sown, scarcely has their stem taken root in the earth, when he blows upon them and they wither, and the tempest carries them off like stubble. To whom then will you compare me, or who is my equal, says the Holy One? Lift up your eyes on high and see. Who created these? He who brings out their host and numbers them, calling them all by name. Because he is great in strength, mighty in power, not one is missing. Why do you say, O Jacob, and speak, O Israel, my way is hidden from the Lord, and my right is disregarded by my God? Have you not known? Have you not heard? The Lord is the everlasting God, the creator of the ends of the earth. He does not faint or grow weary. His understanding is unsearchable. He gives power to the faint and strengthens the powerless. Even youths will faint and be weary, and the young will fall exhausted. But those who wait for the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings like eagles. They shall run and not be weary. They shall walk and not faint. Thanks be to God.
Thank you, Lynn. Thank you. Our next hymn is Great Is Thy Faithfulness, and you'll see it's wrongly numbered on our order of service and mistyped. The number is 153. 153, the hymn Great Is Thy Faithfulness. 153. I don't think there is any doubt at all that Isaiah chapter 40 is one of the most stirring passages in the Old Testament. The whole chapter is full of imagery and pictures of suggesting the power and the strength of God. Now, of course, it's written as an appeal to a people living in exile, people who have lost sight of God. It's a time when the people of Israel have been captured and sent to exile in Babylon. And as happens in these circumstances, distance breaks the contact between them and their history, their culture, and everything that makes them unique. They've actually lost contact with their roots. And so the prophet Isaiah calls them back. Cause them to remember who and what they are. They are the people of God. They are the people of Israel. God's chosen people. He calls them to remember. To remember that it was God who created the stars and the sky, that God is more powerful than all the rulers of the earth, that God is the one who really, really cares if they are suffering. But Isaiah, of course, is not just trying to stir their memories and remind them of what God has done for them. He's also reminding them that throughout the ages, God has been loyal to them, and that they, in return, owe God a debt of loyalty. Do you not know? Have you not heard what God has done? He says to them. Well then, how could you turn away from it? Good question. Now, loyalty, of course, is something we all value. And in the course of our lives, there are many conflicting calls of loyalty made upon us. We are called to be loyal to our families, our children, and our friends. Our workplace demands our loyalty. We feel a sense of loyalty to our country and our community, and we want to put something back into it. And so we get involved in different areas of the community. There is a sense of loyalty towards any of the clubs we may belong to, the golf club or the bowling club or whatever. And there is that sense of loyalty towards the idea of justice, of honesty and fair play. And yes, of course, there is our loyalty to God. There's no doubt about it. In life, there are many calls upon our loyalty. And sometimes those calls contradict each other. They clash. And we have to disappoint someone. And there can be few working parents, for example, who haven't had to disappoint children or families because of their work commitments. And how often do we hear of people's involvement or commitment to a club or community affairs causing friction at home? How often have we been let down by family or friends? And how often have we let them down? But today of all days, as we unite here in worship, the one thing we can say is that whereas our loyalty is sometimes a transient thing, dependent upon our individual circumstances and the chances of our lives, the loyalty of God is not like that at all. In fact, in many cases, it's the one fixed point in our lives, that throughout all the changes, all the ups and downs, all the incidents, the one thing that is constant in our lives is the loyalty of God. And yes, yeah, we sometimes doubt that. And at difficult times, when things are going against us, we ask the question, why? But you know, even in asking that question, we are in fact recognizing that God is in control. That's not the why question. It's not a question searching for God. It's a question asked when we have found God and are searching for understanding. This passage from Isaiah, the overriding theme is the constant loyalty of God. He affirms that the loyalty of God was there for the past, is here in the present, and will be there in the future. If any one of you would doubt that, I would ask you to consider this. If the future of our national church had been left simply to man's devices, would it have survived? Would it have survived all the changes, all the unions, all the transitions, all the conflicts, all the rebuilding, all that's gone on in this nation over the last 2,000 years? Would it have survived the changes in fashion, the changes in lifestyle, if the hand of God had not been behind it? If you think back and you reflect upon all the turmoil and all the changes that the church has gone through in its history, I would suggest that it's a point worth thinking about. So I would want to say that the loyalty of God has been a fixed point in the history of this church. And during the difficult times, when the people of this community and this country have drifted away, just as the people of Israel did, then he has been there, doing what the prophet Isaiah said he would do. In verses 29 to 31, we are told, he strengthens those who are weak and tired. Those who trust in the Lord will find their strength renewed. They will rise on wings like eagles. They will run and not get weary. They will walk and not get weak. When this church has struggled, God has given strength to those who carried the burden, to those who remained faithful. He gave energy, courage, and a vision for the future. His loyalty and his presence carried them through. What is true of the past is true of the present, and is true for the future. In the life of this church, and of ourselves as individuals, the loyalty of God is the one fixed point in our lives. Through that loyalty, we receive a certainty, not just for the present, not just for the past, but also for the future. A loyalty which guarantees that as we worship together and celebrate what God has done in the last 2,000 years, and we strive and we work and we struggle to lay the foundations for the next 2,000, and while we may weary, while we may tire, while we may struggle, we have Isaiah's promise that we shall rise like eagles, we shall run and not grow weary, we shall walk and not grow tired. Amen. We sing together now hymn number 100, hymn number 465. 465, the hymn, Be Thou My Vision. 465.
Thank you.
cry before God in prayer. Let us pray. O gracious and loving God, if we have gifts to bring before you today, it is simply because of your free mercy. For all things are yours, and everything that we have comes from you. And so we ask that you accept the offerings that we now make today, and grant that gifts which can never be worthy may yet be hallowed by your blessing and used in your service. So that as we enjoy and experience your blessings of love, of grace, of peace, and forgiveness, others in this community may share those same blessings too. This we ask through our Lord and Saviour, Jesus Christ. Amen. And now we simply unite as one family and come before God with our prayers for others. And I'll ask Rosa to lead us in those prayers today.
Let us pray together. Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, as we gather before you this morning, we share our concerns for others and also for ourselves. We pray for Christians around the world who are living in fear for their lives due to persecution or hatred. Please protect and guide them. Keep them safe as they serve you. We pray this morning for the people affected by the airstrikes in Gaza, also for the people of Taiwan as they come under intimidation by China. Support them and help them to stay strong. Creator God, you entrusted the earth into our care. Show us how to repair the heart and heal the damage as we all depend on this earth for our daily needs. We can see climate change having such far-reaching effects. Lord, we are aware of the hunger crisis in East Africa. May we strive to do all we can through humanitarian aid to help prevent famine. We pray against the destruction, harm, and greed we see all around us. We pray for the situation in Ukraine after 5 months of conflict. We pray for peace, for all those who are working for peace, and for the success of the initiative to export Ukraine's grain. Loving Father, we pray for all of the United Kingdom as we face a big recession, and ask for your help for all in need. As the grip of further food shortages takes hold, support to food banks is even more necessary. May those of us who have never hesitate to offer help to those who have not. Faithful God, we thank you for all who care for us every day, especially those we take for granted. We pray for all NHS workers who are worn out and weary, that they may be given more support by central government. We pray for all other workers in the public sector, as all they ask for is a fair deal. Lord, at this time, as we host the Commonwealth Games in Birmingham, grant that all who have been injured in any way, physically or emotionally, may soon be restored to full health. As these friendly games draw to a close, may all participants and supporters travel back home safely. Lord, in your mercy, hear all these our prayers, in Jesus' name. Amen.
Thank you, Rosa, thank you. We close our service then by singing together hymn number 154, the hymn, O Lord My God, When I in Awesome Wonder. And after the threefold benediction, as is our custom, we'll sing the Lowman benediction, which you'll find on the back of your order of service. That's 154, Lord my God, when I, in awesome wonder. And now may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be upon you and remain with you, here now and forevermore.
God be with you.